was born in a barn where all of the other animals are born. And the reason why this baby was born in a barn, because this baby was to be the lamb. To take away all the sins of the world that's mine and yours. And today, we come to celebrate the birth of that baby and the impact that that birth has had on our lives. So let us all bow our heads at this time. Dear Father in Heaven, we thank you so much for all that you have done for us. Lord, you gave us a gift that we could never say thank you enough for. For Lord, how many parents would give up their one and only child to die for those who didn't want them? To die for those who chose to go another direction. But you allowed him to die just so that we would have a chance to be restored back to the place that you originally had us. And we come this morning, Lord, just to say thank you for the son that you allowed to be born by Mary and Joseph. We come to say thank you for allowing a king to be born in a barn around other animals. We come to say thank you, Lord, for the gift that you gave us during this special time. Lord, to show us how much you love us. So, Lord, we ask this morning that our praise and worship that we give to you will be acceptable in your sight, because we come to say thank you, and we come in celebration of the gift that you gave us. In Jesus' name, let us all say, amen. Let us repeat our call of worship found in Matthew chapter 28, verses 18 through 20. Let us all say it together. And Jesus came unto them and said, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen.
Before the dawn of creation, before the first blade of tender grass sprang from the earth, before the world was baptized with the first light, before the morning stars sang together, before the worlds were created, when the earth was without form and void, before God spoke the earth into existence, God knew that man was fallen. God knew that we would need a Savior. God knew that Christ would have to die for us. From the time that Adam and Eve wandered off in sin, God went to great lengths to restore that relationship by sending his one and only Son, the Messiah, Jesus Christ. The prophecies about the Messiah begin with Genesis 3:15. And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. Genesis 12:3. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. And all peoples on earth will be blessed through you. Deuteronomy 18:15. The Lord your God will raise you up a prophet like me among you from your fellow Israelites. You must listen to him. Micah 5:2. But you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, though you are smiled on the clans of Judah, out of you will come from me one who will be ruler over Israel, whose origins are from of old ancient times. Isaiah 7:14. Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a son. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and we will call him Emmanuel. 2 Samuel 7:16. Your house and your kingdom will endure forever before me. Your throne will be established forever. Isaiah 9:16-7. For to you a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, a Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. Isaiah 53:5. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. The prophecies about the Messiah were not just a bunch of scattered predictions placed here and there in the Old Testament, but they are a unified promise, each promise connected to the other. What would the world be like without the Messiah? What would Christmas be like without the fulfillment of these ancient promises and the prospect of a Messiah? Today, we celebrate the fulfillment of these promises in the Old Testament. We celebrate the arrival of baby Jesus. We celebrate God dwelling with his people. We celebrate Emmanuel, God with us. We celebrate Jesus, the one born by the power of the Holy Spirit to be God with us. Today, we celebrate, for God so loved.
Rescue Mary Jensen, a waiting danger, and we wish you a Merry Christmas. Can we say amen? Amen. Celebrating Jesus is an everyday thing for me. I can't help it because he does so much for me. Every day of my life, he demonstrates his power. And I choose to celebrate him every day. But today, in this church, we are celebrating the birth of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I'm excited about that. How about you? A little over 2,000 years ago, the Son of God put on human flesh, being miraculously conceived in Mary, the King of Kings, was born into Roman conditions in the town of Bethlehem, just as prophesied in Micah 5:2. There, in that lowly shed, Jesus the Savior was born and laid in a manger. In that rude cradle lay the Son of the Christ. His holy presence has filled the courts of heaven with glory. Yet this glorious being loved the poor sinner, as all of us are, and took upon himself the form of a servant, that he might suffer and die for us. It was for our sake that Jesus chose to exchange the riches of heaven for the poverty of earth. The adoration of the heavenly throne he exchanged for the mockery abused by wicked men. Because of his love for us, he accepted a life of hardship and a death of shame. All this our Christ did to show just how much God loves us. How do we celebrate the greatest gift ever given? We glorify, we testify, we recognize. Let me say that again. How do we celebrate the greatest gift ever given? We do what? Glorify, we testify, we recognize. The priests and rulers among the Jews were not ready to welcome Jesus. They were too proud to think that the Messiah as being a helpless child. So when Christ was born, God did not reveal it to them. He sent good news to some shepherds. According to Dr. Luke in chapter 2, verse 9 through 20, NIV version, an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news, and that will cause great joy for all people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. You will find a baby wrapped in clothes and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing the Lord has told us about." So they found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word, and all who heard it were amazed. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen. How do we celebrate the greatest gift ever given? We glorify, we testify, we recognize. The wise men departed alone from Jerusalem. The shadows of night were falling as they fell, left the gates. But to their great joy, they again saw the star and were directed to Bethlehem. They had received no such indication of the lowly estate of Jesus as was given to the shepherds. At Bethlehem, they found no royal guard stationed to protect the newborn king. None of the world's honored men were in attendance. Jesus was cradled in a manger. His parents, uneducated peasants, were his only guardians. Could this be he of whom it was written that he should raise up the tribes of Jacob and restore the preserves of Israel, that he should be a light to the Gentiles and for salvation unto the ends of the earth? Isaiah 49:6. When they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary, his mother, and fell down, and they worshiped him. Beneath the lowly guise of Jesus, they recognized the presence of divinity. They gave their hearts to him as their Savior, and then poured out their gifts of gold and frankincense and myrrh. How do we celebrate the greatest gift ever given? We glorify God as faithful Father and friend. We testify of his sovereign power to forgive and set free. We recognize that he alone can save us and accept the gift. Let us celebrate the life of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Praise his name. Thank you.
Thank you. chapter 1, verses 18 through 25, records Joseph's acceptance of Jesus. It reads, "This is how the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, 'Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins.' All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet, 'The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel,' which means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate their marriage until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus. At the birth of Jesus, the shepherds, the wise men, and the angels celebrated with special gifts, with songs of praise, and with prayers. They realized that this was a momentous occasion and that his birth needed to be celebrated. According to the angel's message, Jesus was destined to save us from our sins. To celebrate symbolizes an acknowledgement of something or someone significant, commemorated publicly with respect, with festivity, with honor, with rejoicing, and with praise. The name of Jesus is worthy of celebration. Remember, according to the angel's message to Joseph, he was destined to save us from our sins. Jesus, the Messiah, the anointed one who was appointed before the world came into existence. Jesus, the prophet of the Lord, who is the fulfillment of God's holy word. Jesus, the priest of God, a living sacrifice. The good shepherd, the master teacher, the righteous judge, the great physician, the bread of life, a light in darkness, a way when there is no way. Jesus, an advocate with God, an intercessor, a mediator. He is hope. He is peace. He is love. He is joy. Jesus is the creator and sustainer of all things, the savior of all mankind. Jesus, the very thought of thee, with sweetness fills my breath. But sweet is far thy face to see, and in thy presence rest. No voice can sing, nor heart can flame, nor can the memory find a sweeter sound than thy blessed name, O Savior of mankind. O hope of every contrite heart, O joy of all the meek. To those who fall, how kind thou art, how good to those who seek. Jesus should be celebrated, for he is the reigning King of Kings, the exalted Son of God, who, according to the angel, came to earth just to save me. and just to save you, celebrating our Savior.
Turned away, born in a stable, in a manger. God today that I didn't have yesterday. And not that I didn't appreciate him, I just came a little closer to him today. And so it made a different impression in my life. I got a hallelujah in me today, so I'm just going to say it. The Lord is truly blessed, amen. It's been a good day. There's a song that says, oh, come, let us adore him. Christ, the Lord, we're going to slow it down. We're going to make it really touchy-feely. Yeah, that one. That's it. And I'm going to invite you to sing it with us for just a hot minute until it starts to work something inside. And we're going to sing it until somebody feels something in this room. And here's the thing. I want you to have the opportunity to praise him today. So we just going to hang out here so you can get the opportunity to praise him today. Is that all right? Amen. You know the song that says, come, let us adore him. Everybody, all over the room. Let's sing together, everybody. Oh. Right now. And somebody was crazy enough to think that it's possible for God to not love you. Somebody's been crazy enough to think that salvation is not available to you. I've got some really good news for somebody in here. The scripture clearly says that whosoever believes will not perish. Friends, what that says to me is, no matter what you did, if you just believe, as the scripture says, whosoever believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life. If you just believe, eternal life is yours. That's it. God loved and he gave. So we must believe and receive. The doors of this church are open. And if you just want to reconnect with that old, good old feeling of God's love for you, like you knew it once before, I invite you to stand on your feet. If you want a different kind of relationship with God than you had in the past, I invite you to stand. If you just want somebody to pray for you, because you just want to get to know him for yourself, I invite you to stand to your feet. If you want to just say, Lord, I believe that you will save me. I'm a sinner. I've messed up some stuff. But I believe that when you died on the cross, that blood was sufficient for me. And I want to be saved. Unless we accept salvation, let's not let it be meaningless. Let's choose today to say, Lord, I accept you, and I want you in my life. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for your many blessings. Thank you, Lord, for the way that you love on us. Lord, thank you that your love for us is your love for us, Lord, is based on your character, not our conduct. Thank you, Lord, that a net was already put in place for Donna's sins. Lord, thank you that you would have done it all if only one were saved. So God, help us to leave this place truly personalizing that sacrifice. Understanding, it's a global discussion and it's something we all personal faith. And Lord, help us to not forfeit the sacrifice of Jesus by refusing to believe that Jesus saves. But help us to accept and believe once and for all that there is nothing that separates us from you, from your love. So Lord, for the person that's feeling alone and pushed aside because they think they're not good enough, Lord, draw them back in. I've been away too long. Lord, draw them back in. And God, please commission each and every person in this room today. Lord, commission every one of us to be ambassadors for the kingdom. And God, help us to choose words and thoughts that bring healing, comfort, and love. We thank you for this time. And Lord, we thank you for the gift of Jesus. We thank you that we're not worth it, but you gave the best of you. Thank you, Lord, for the sacrifice. Thank you, Lord, for salvation. And thank you, Lord, that we know that one day, soon and very soon, we will see you. Thank you for this time together. In your name we pray, amen. Amen.
Yeah. King, our Savior and Lord, is leading, today we promise to follow Him. Thank you again for meeting with us this Sabbath day. As we worship you today, it felt like we were close to heaven. Lord, we pray that you will give us this spirit during this week and the rest of our lives. Help us to always honor you and give you the respect due your name. Thank you again for this church and these songs and words that we spoke to honor and praise you. Be with us as we leave this place. Help us never to leave your presence. Let everybody say, Amen.